My name is Sebastian Ray. I am the curator for ancient Mesopotamia and director of the Girsu Project. And I'm just about to travel to Iraq, where the sun is radiant almost always, and the archaeology is truly heaven.
I'm Ashley Pooley. I'm one of the archaeologists here, and it's a bit wet.
Hi, my name's Dr. Gareth Brereton, and I'm the object registrar at the site of Tello, ancient Girsu.
Hello, my name is Stefka. I'm the objects conservator for Girsu Project.
Hi, I'm Ellie. I'm the photographer for the Girsu Project.
Hello, I'm John Taylor. I'm curator of cuneiform collections at the British Museum.
And welcome to my corner.
Girsu is one of the great treasures of Iraq heritage. This is one of their greatest archaeological sites. This is the site which revealed to the world the existence of the Sumerians. The Sumerians having invented, of course, writing at the end of the 4th millennium BC. The site was excavated by a team of French archaeologists in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. Now, this was the pioneering age of archaeology in Iraq. Most of the remains, including the finds, were unearthed at great speed, and they were poorly recorded. Now, one of the aims of our new project is to go back to these late 19th and early 20th century excavations to salvage what can be salvaged, what the French archaeologists left behind. And these are huge, huge spoil heaps, dumps of soil that the French archaeologists moved in order to excavate the sites. And so today, we are going through the spoil heaps, discovering and rescuing objects, including tablets. These tablets belong to the great palace archives of the kings of Girsu. And after 6 weeks of work in October, November last year, we were able to rescue more than 200 of these clay tablets. So in this video, you'll see the journey, the ideal journey of a tablet being rescued from a 19th century spoil heap, brought to the dig house, registered, conserved on-site, photographed, the photographs sent to the British Museum for preliminary translation, and then sent at the end of the season to the Iraq Museum in Baghdad.
So behind me, there's a big spoil heap which was left by the French excavators in the early years of the last century. After a lot of consideration, we came to the conclusion that under the spoil heap, there's possibly the remains of part of the administrative centre of the ancient city of Girsu. On a daily basis, it varies. It varies between where we're digging, so we can control it a little because we know where the tablets are coming from now, thanks to our massive trench. We vary between 4 and 20 tablets each day, and in total we've recovered around about 200 tablets. Most of the tablets are they're either very small, about the size of a postage stamp, or a bit larger, but today we found a tablet which is complete and is much larger and will be easier for you to see, and to see the kind of deposits that it's coming out of and how we excavated as well. Okay, so this is what the French material looks like. It's sort of very loose. It's basically composed of mud brick and little lenses of charcoal. And within it, we have this tablet, which is more or less complete. So you can see that it's rectangular. It sort of swells slightly in section, but it has very well-defined corners. And this is unusually complete. It's not uniquely complete, but it is pretty unusually complete. So we will leave it in this condition, and it will go back to the house, cleaned up very carefully, photographed, and then passed down the chain, eventually to John at the British Museum, for him to read it and tell us what's on it. The man who found this, Ali, has been working with us for a long time now. We know Ali as Mr. Brick, because he's very, very, very good at mud brick. Yeah, maybe Professor Brick today.
Thank you.
Ali is just basically cleaning off the face. We'll look for the tablets sort of bulging out of the section, carefully work around them, and then take them out, while damaging them as little as possible. The writing is really small. I mean, you're talking about letters which are sort of maybe 2 or 3 millimeters, and it's very, very easy to damage and to destroy a sign here or there. And this can make all the difference in terms of the reading of the word.
So after a morning of hard excavation work by the archaeologists, they come to me in the afternoon with their bags of muddy objects and then put them in my inbox here. My job is to basically, at this stage, record all the available information that we have about this object. So that could include, for example, the site it came from, which is Tello, the year, so it's 2022, the area it was excavated from on the site, the context, and that's the archaeological context where the object was found. We have something called the small finds number, which is a number that was given by the archaeologist to that specific object. And I register all this information in a database. I then look at the object, figure out what it is, and most of the time it's fairly obvious, write a short description, record the measurements, and then give it a special number that only this object has. So here we have a tablet that's just been excavated. As you can see, it's very small, but it's complete, which is great because most of the tablets we do find here are fragmentary. Complete tablets are quite rare. We know it's rectangular in shape, and we know from the horizontal lines that we can kind of see across the surface that it was probably inscribed on both sides of the tablet. It's at the moment it's covered in silt and clay and needs to be cleaned, so we do not know yet what information this tablet contains. So now this tablet's going to go to my colleague Stefka for conservation, and then hopefully when she cleans it we'll be able to see what's inscribed upon the surface.
So once the object is registered and first assessment is made by our registrar, Garrett, I investigate further under magnification just to determine what's the best approach to treat the object. So my first assessment obviously is looking at stability, because in the moment the object is taken out of the ground, we basically change its environment. So we expose it to external factors that could damage it. So my job is basically to prevent this damage to happen, and like a first line of preservation, let's say. So I make sure that the object's preserved in its original state, it's cleaned to make it legible to read, and it's stabilized, packed and safe, ready to go to the museum in Baghdad. On the first look, the tablet is stable, but it's covered with soil, so I cannot really see much of the inscription. I can see that there is something underneath. The soil doesn't have a signs of salts, which is a good sign. And as we've worked on this type of tablets already, I know that the clay actually, it's quite stable, very good quality. So I would expect the soil will be easier to clean, and hopefully there will be a fully preserved inscription underneath. This season is a bit more challenging from object conservation point of view, as we receive a lot of cuneiform tablets. So they're non-fired, you know, very lightly sun-dried clay. And the challenge is basically to keep them intact and stable, depending on which context they're found and which layer. Some of them come already dry and the soil is very hard. So those are really hard to clean and also to see whether there is any inscription preserved. Another tablets from another context arrive actually wet. I leave them to dry a little bit, but only to a stage where it's possible to clean. Otherwise, soluble salts start appearing to the surface, which cause cracking and also loss of surface, which we don't want. That's why the sooner I clean and stabilize the environment, and slowly dry the tablet, the better. Very dry cuneiforms. I need to actually make sure that I'm not removing surface while trying to remove a very hard soil on top. So I basically, there is an opposite treatment where I have to slightly damp the soil. It will reduce the risk of damage and loss of surface. As an object conservator, this has been most probably the most challenging job in general ever. Very rarely someone gets to actually work on just freshly excavated from the ground cuneiform. They're very rare, and usually you find them only in museums, already conserved and stable, so it is a big opportunity for me as well.
I've just received a tablet that's come from conservation, and I'm going to photograph it. So I need to photograph finds of all sorts. We get through the studio about 12 to 15 tablets a day. It takes anywhere between 10 minutes to half an hour, depending on how broken the tablet is, how curved the tablet is. We have to photograph the tablet with the light in the top left-hand corner so that the shadows are in the correct place to be read. We photograph the tablet 6 times. The writing on the tablet reads down the front, and then we flip it on its horizontal axis and then read down the back of it. And some of the writing goes on top or bottom or either side. So we photograph front, bottom, back, top, left and right. And then we put it into a net in Photoshop and send them to John Taylor in London, who then transcribes them.
We found a number of different groups of tablets from the site. So some of them are school practice tablets, basically. Others are to do with one type of thing. Perhaps there's a group that mentioned a particular official. They must have belonged together at one point in the ancient world. This one is a piece of administration. It's the kind of thing we expect from the site. Most tablets from this period are paperwork from big institutions like a palace or a temple. They're sucking in raw commodities, they're processing them, and they're distributing them to other organizations or to people who need to use them. These types of tablets are usually quite easy to identify just from looking at them, really. So you start out and perhaps you get the size and the shape, and you have a little look at the writing. You look for key things like maybe there are numbers, and very quickly you'll get an idea of roughly what it is. So you can generally tell these administrative texts quite quickly. Okay, before actually reading the text, I would expect that it would be something to do with barley or sheep as the foundations of the economy. And actually, having read it, it is indeed something to do with barley, mostly. It's different types of flour. And the text says that these are regular offerings for something called the household. I'm not sure which household that is, actually, but it will be probably one of the temples. So there are different grades of flour. There's a fine one, there's a coarse one, a few other types, and one of them we think is semolina. And they are being distributed to various officials. So in the case of this particular tablet, we have a number of people. There's somebody called Barimu. There's somebody else called Utume'e. And there's somebody called Ush'e. Unfortunately, we don't yet know those people from other tablets. And at the end, there's a total where, hopefully, if the scribe has done his sums right, there'll be a figure that he can carry forward to his end-of-year accounts to work out whether there's a debit or a credit. So I've got here another tablet. It's not the tablet from Tello. It's another one that's been in the collection for many, many years. It's very similar to that tablet, though, in that it's a list of different types of flour and grain and things being distributed to people. In this particular example, There are a few juicy details, actually. One of them is that there's a group of 37 people who are receiving these rations, I guess, and they're described as translators. Unfortunately, though, it doesn't say which languages they're translating between. From these tablets, we can learn all sorts of different occupations that people might have had, whether they're working in the fields, it's an activity rather than a real job, but there are leather workers, there are skilled silversmiths. If we're really lucky, the tablet might have something we call a year name, which is their way of counting time. But rather than counting from an arbitrary start point and going 1, 2, 3, 4, each year has a specific name of something really exciting that happened in the previous year. And that's quite valuable information for us because we have very little political history from this time, the kings and what they do, the building and the battles and things like that. So actually the year names from the paperwork can often tell us the, sort of the bigger picture, the political history of the ancient city. Once they've read the text, I will go back to a Google sheet that we all share, and I will put in basic information, really the headlines, the key information about the date, the content, what type of text it is, or if it mentions an institution or a person, something like that. After the main excavation report is published, we'll have to also do a more detailed study of the tablets themselves and exactly what they say. And we will do that in collaboration also with an Iraqi colleague who will join as what we call an epigrapher of the site. In order to make the most use out of these tablets, we need to put them back into groups if we can, because individually they're not particularly exciting. They're not a great story of literature, or they're not the heartfelt pleas from one person to another. It's administrative material, it's paperwork, it's bureaucracy. But when you put them together into these groups, you can understand perhaps the career of an official. You can understand perhaps the scale of the economy, how things are moving around, and you can understand, life in the ancient city once you collect them back into what might have been their archives, if you like, the dossier that they came from.
Oh, is there anything else you would like to say?
I think it's important to say to acknowledge the fact that a lot of Iraq's archaeology is in other places. It's been taken elsewhere. The culture's been appropriated in some way. We have collections in Istanbul and in London and in Paris, but this tablet and all of the others that we find will go to Baghdad, and they will stay in Baghdad. Iraqi people will have collections of tablets, of archives from their past. And that fundamentally is why I'm here.